Now we're ready to look at modern systems of classification, and these take what's called a phylogenetic approach. So we've seen phonetics, which was Linnaeus's method of just looking at physical similarities. What we want to do now is to take into account phylogeny, which actually means the evolutionary history of lineage. Now within phylogenetics, there are several different specific techniques. The first one is known as cladistics, and this identifies clades based on branching points. And in fact, clade is just a Greek word that means branch. So we're going to have family trees, as it were, evolutionary trees, and they're going to split off. We're going to see where those branching events take place. That's cladistics. And then secondly is called evolutionary taxonomy. And this not only takes into account that there are branching points, but it wants to know how long ago those took place. So it inspects the degree of divergence as well as the fact that there was a branching point. Now, Darwin, in his sketchbooks, while he was still on the Beagle, drew out this very first phylogeny. And he recognized that, he said, our classifications of species, he's seeing all these different points as being different species of animal from a common ancestor. He's saying our classifications will come to be, as far as they can be so made, genealogies, so family trees. Common ancestry, similarities by descent. So here's a family tree. So we have grandmother down at the bottom. She had two children, and that's you. You're going to be Joe for this one. And so this is your mom, okay? And this is your sister, so this is the closest relative to you. And so there are what we're going to soon see are sister taxa, because they're the most recent divergence. And then there's the immediate ancestors, the mother, and then two generations back. And then there's a divergent group over here. Your mother's brother is your uncle, okay? And then they have offspring over here, and those are your cousins. So we're keeping track of these relationships within the family. We have terms for this, sister and cousins, mother and uncle. And we're going to keep that same kind of relationship tracking when we look at species. So here's Darwin's more formal genealogy or phylogeny of the Galapagos finches. We saw this in the last lecture. And here we have a common ancestor to all these lineages that live today in the Galapagos. And fringillidae refers to the family of birds that includes these genera. Geospitza we saw as one of the genus of Darwin's finches, and then some of these others. So we have a common ancestor that gave rise to this genus, Geospitza, then Camarincus, another genus of Darwin's finches, and then they then diversified out here, and there's several different species within the genus Camarincus, and there's several different species of Geospitza within this genus. Okay, so it's the same thing going back several generations, in this case it would be hundreds or thousands of generations, to that common ancestor. So, fascinatingly, in terms of Darwin's own acuity, his own accuracy in making these kinds of classifications, he said, you know, there's one major group of the Galapagos finches, and they're all insectivorous. And there's another over here, the ground finches and the cactus-feeding ones, that have the genus name Geospitza. And I bet that they are truly different from each other. And so we can look at this today with modern techniques. So this is now a modern classification. Here are the seed eaters in the genus Geospitza. So you have the large ground finch, the medium, the small, then other kinds of ground finches, and here are the cactus finches here. And so Darwin said these might have had a similar common ancestor, and that appears to be correct. And the ancestral finch here indeed probably did come from the South American mainland. The closest relative to this grouping is called the blue-black grassquit. And then here's this other group, the insect eaters that Darwin differentiated and said that these would be separate from the Geospitza. So there's a Camarincus group down here, and there's the small, large, and medium tree finches, mangrove finches, etc., etc. These do indeed have a more common recent ancestor, and that's a separate sublineage, again, descended from the blue-black grass quit, just like these, but the separation between this larger group and this one occurred much, much longer ago in evolutionary history. Now, Linnaeus based his classifications purely on physical similarities, and so did Darwin. Until recently, that's all we had to work with. And the challenge for understanding from a Darwinian viewpoint and evolutionary history, we want to find traits that remain similar through evolutionary time. And there are indeed certain physical similarities that provide insights into ancestry. So if we look at the forearm of vertebrates, the ancestral type, and this would be typical of, say, an early amphibian or very early reptile, they have the upper arm, the two arm bones here, the radius and the ulna, wrist bones, and then finger bones. And this basic theme is still seen today in our arms. We have the same basic structure in our arms as did the forearms of the amphibia, and seen here with these frogs, still similar. Lizards too, very similar. And there are some species that have specialized their limbs so that, say, the whale, they have now paddling fins, so their upper arm is now very short, but it's still that one single upper arm bone, then the radius and ulna here close together, much shortened, fewer wrist bones, and then the finger bones have been elongated to make a proper flipper. Bats, likewise, have been modified, but there's still the upper arm, then the radius and ulna here, and then all the finger bones. Even in the horse, we see same use of these bones. So these things that are common are because there's just been modification during the descent of these new species from the original ones. And so these similarities are not accidental. They're because of common descent. Okay? And so this is a really important concept that we're going to revisit many times in this course, that of homology. That you see certain similarities between different species, and they are similar because they share a recent common ancestor. Now, when the cladists perform their cladistic analysis, they're looking for traits that will appear within an evolutionary lineage and then are retained in subsequent species. And so what they're trying to do is to find a series of traits that they're confident reflect homology, that is, common ancestry. And so let's say we have a classification we want to make that involves five different species, and we'll call these species A, B, C, D, and E. And there's a series of different physical characteristics that we assume, once they've evolved, they'll be retained in subsequent generations, in subsequent species. And so these are going to be characteristics 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, from this, we can construct an evolutionary tree. And the logic of it goes like this. Let's say that we find a certain trait that's common in most species. And say, out of the five species we're interested in here, A through E, four of them have very large eye sockets. Okay, that would imply that in the evolutionary history, the evolution of eye sockets happened early, just when all these other groups branched off from species A. And it's been retained in all daughter groups ever since. The second trait would be opposable thumbs, okay? So that happened here. It was retained in all of these descendant groups here, but is not present in any of the others. So the trait evolved once, and it was retained in all the daughter groups derived from that original ancestor. Then the loss of a tail happens here. And again, these all have tails, these don't. And we'd say, oh, the tail was lost only once. So it's a single evolutionary event, and all descendants of this tailless ancestor have retained an absence of a tail. Some of them may then have adopted a modified gait, so perhaps they could walk upright rather than knuckle walk. And again, we say that probably evolved once here, and so that both of these species retain this because of that single evolutionary event early in their ancestry. And then finally, just this species has developed language species E. Okay? And so that's the last thing that happens. And so if we're particularly interested in this particular species, and as we'll see when we look at human evolution much later in the course, we will be, these are the things that narrow us down and make us more precisely what we are compared to all the other species in our larger family of primates.